A very good morning to you all. Actually, the idea of organizing such a webinar or a series of lectures was actually mooted by Dr. Umakant Mishra and his team in Gangadhar Mehr University, Sambalpur. And it is a very innovative and constructive idea to start the program. And I am fortunate enough to be associated with this series of lectures. In fact, this is the first lecture of the series. And this is the COVID situation. And we are supposed to Okay, welcome back. Now, in this COVID situation, we are supposed to take social distance. But I was doing both social distance and digital distance. And this should be the norm, new norm nowadays, to be wedded to the digital mode. And throughout the country, we are doing this. And now, this is also one way of teaching to the students in the classroom and even organizing seminars. So instead of wasting any more time, we should focus on our discussion today. And today I will speak on a very different aspect of which many of you may not be knowing, and it is the numerical system in Orisha. The meaning is that how in ancient period people were counting the numbers, writing the numbers, expressing the numbers. Now, we are all acquainted with a different type of or system of numeration, and that is very popular throughout the world. And this is known as the decimal system of notation. And in this decimal system of notation, we have nine figures and a zero. And there is also the system of using zero as a potential one. Now take for example, in the figure 100, the two zeros are there on the right side of one. So we call it 100. And these two zeros are potential zeros. But this type of numeration or the decimal system of notation was not known to the people living in earlier days. They were using a different kind of notation altogether. And that system was known as the numerical system of notation. It was quite different from decimal system of notation in many respects. And we have also other systems of notations which were prevalent in ancient days. So today we shall discuss on three major systems of notations. One is the numerical system of notation that was quite ancient in India. The other one is the decimal system of notation that is quite prevalent throughout the world today, and we are all acquainted with this. And the third thing is that the chronogrammatic use of notation or the chronogrammatic system of notation. Now, first of all, we have to discuss the numerical system of notation. What is this? Now, in this numerical system of notation, there are actually 20 figures or 20 symbols. And with these 20 symbols, all the figures are expressed. Now, for 1 to 9, there are 9 unit figures, and from 10 to 90 there are similarly 9 symbols, and there is also a symbol for 100 and 1000. So all total 20 symbols were there, and with the help of these 20 symbols people were expressing different numbers. And to be more precise, we have the numbers which are written in inscriptions of India, and that range from 1 to 70,000. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and then 10 to 90, nine symbols are there. And with the help of these symbols, 70,000 is the highest number that is written in an inscription in Nasik caves. And the date of the inscription is maybe 1st century BC, and it was a Satavahana inscription. So from the area, from the Western Ghats, we find a number of examples where numbers having some thousands, they are expressed in the inscriptional literature of India. Now, if you take into account the numbers or the numerical system of notation that was prevalent in India, you will find the Asokan inscriptions are there, and in Minor Rock Edict 1, you will find the numbers that are written in the inscriptions. And after Asokan inscriptions, we have a number of examples from the time of the Satavahanas, the Western Kshatrapas, who were ruling particularly in the western part of India. They used this numerical system of notation, and gradually it was popular among the people in different other parts of the country. And the Western Kshatrapa inscriptions are there, in which we find the numerical system of notation. And apart from this, even in the coins, because Western Kshatrapas had issued a number of coins, copper coins and silver coins. Particularly in the silver coins, they had the habit of writing the year of the ruler, and that is written in figures, that is written in numerical symbols. So from coins and inscriptions of western part of India, and to some extent in the southern part of India, and even to some extent from the Mathura region, when the Kushanas were there in the northern part of India in the 1st, 2nd, 3rd centuries AD, we find a number of inscriptions from Mathura, Lucknow, and other places in northern India, where we find the notational system was also prevalent. So from those areas, the system began to spread to other localities. And in Odisha, we find the use of numerical notation in different ruling dynasties, in the inscriptions of different ruling dynasties, and particularly during the time of the Mathuras, who were ruling in Kalinga region, we find a number of examples where the numerical system of notation was widely prevalent. And similarly, during the time of the Nalas and the Saraupuriyas, who were ruling in the western part of Orisha, we also find in the inscriptions the use of the numerical system of notations. And similarly, in the western part of India, in the northern part of India, and even in the central part of India, there were a number of smaller kingdoms who were ruling over different pockets or territorial units, and they were the Vigras, Dattas, and Mudgalas. These minor dynasties, they were also using the numerical system of notations in their inscriptions. So now we shall come to how the system was working then, and what are the major modes in expressing the numbers. Now, I have already told you that there were 9 symbols to express 9 unit figures, 1 to 9. And similarly, from 10 to 90, we find 9 other symbols. And similarly, for 100, there is a symbol, and for 1000, there is a symbol. Now this, you should remember that this particular system of notation is also known as additive and multiplicative system of notation. Now what is additive and what is multiplicative? Now I shall give you one example in which you can find the in what extent it is or how it can be called as an additive principle or working on the additive principle and how it can be used as a multiplicative principle. Now take for example there are 9 units, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and there are also the symbols up to 90, 9 symbols up to 90, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, and there is a figure for 100, there is a figure for 1000. Now, with the help of all these symbols, we can express different types of numbers. Now this is an, I have already told you that this is an additive and multiplicative system, and in order to express 777, in order to express 777, first of all the symbol for 100 with the symbol for 7 attached to it on the right to be written, For example, if you are writing 700, you have to use the symbol for 100, and then to the right of the symbol for 100, you have to write 7. So it is a multiplicative system where 100 is 100 into 7, it comes to 700. Now similarly, if you are willing to write 900, then you put that symbol for 100, then add 9, the symbol for 9 to it on the right side of the symbol for 100, that it will come to 900. This is a multiplicative system where the 100 place is multiplied, 100 place is multiplied. Similarly, in the 10 place, you have 9 symbols for 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70 and 90. If you want to write 70, you can just use the symbol for 70 in the 10 place. Of course, there is no place value in this system, and in the unit place you can directly put the unit of 7. So in order to express 777, you have to write first of all the symbol for 100 and the symbol for 7 by its side, right side, then the symbol for 70, then for symbol for 7. So in that way it can be calculated as the date of the inscription or the number that is expressing in this inscription as 777. Now similarly, take for a smaller number like 132, you can write the figure for 100, then write 30, then 2. So place value was not here, place value was or cannot be given to this system of numeration, that is completely absent in this system, and only the symbols are there and they are to be put in right places to express a number. Now you have seen the multiplicative side. Now what is the additive side and how the numbers can be added? Now you have to add 700 plus 70 plus 7, then you can get 777. And therefore it is known as an additive and multiplicative system of notation that was quite prevalent throughout India in ancient period. Now there were a number of theories which were propounded by many paleographers, many scholars working on Indian epigraphy. And some scholars believe that this system of notation was derived from the characters of the first letters of the number words. Suppose Eko, Dui, Dui, Tri, Chatur, Pancha. So they thought, at least this proposition came out in the first half of 19th century when Princep and others, James Princep was particularly working on Indian epigraphy. And according to him, that the symbols were expressing the initial letter of the number words. But when we take into account or made a comparison between the first letter of the number words and the symbols of the corresponding number, we do not find any similarity. And that's why the proposition was dismissed long back. And particularly Bhagwan Lal Indraji, who was another great Indian epigraphist, he actually propounded another theory, and that theory was telling that it was not essentially from the first letter of the number words, rather it was invented by the people who were there during the time of Ashoka or before the time of Ashoka. And he particularly emphasized on the Indian origin of the system, because there were many scholars like E.C. Bailey, Alexander Cunningham, who were in favor of expressing that the Indian numerical system was essentially borrowed from other parts of India, other parts of the world like Egypt and Sumeria. But Bhagwan Lal Indraji and others, even G.H. Oja, even Buller, they discounted and they dismissed the idea of any foreign origin of the numerical symbols. Rather, they emphasized on the Indian origin of the numerical system of notation. And till today, we subscribe to the idea of Indraji and others who propounded the theory of indigenous origin of the numerical system of notation. And it was during this time, and this particular trend continued in Orisha. As I told you, in different parts of Orisha, in western Orisha, in southern Orisha, and even in the central and northern part of Orisha, for several centuries, from 3rd century AD to 7th century, we find all the numbers were expressed in the numerical system of notation. And by the 4th, 5th century, we find the symbols which were there in the Ashokan period or in the post-Ashokan period, they were completely changed in their appearance, And there was an evolution of the numbers for more than 800 years, 700, 800 years. And we find in the southern part of India, there was a different type of symbols that were emerging from the original Brahmi symbols. Similarly, in the western part of India, particularly in Vallabhi, Malwa, and the Mekala region, Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, and Gujarat, Maharashtra region, we find the symbols were fast changing in their appearance. And similarly, in the northern part of India, particularly Bihar, Bengal, UP, we find that the numerical symbols were also changing. But the geographical location of Orisha was such that not only the script, along with the script, the numerical systems or the numerical symbols, which were popular in different larger paleographical zones, they were also having their infiltration into the Orishan region. Now, in Orisha, we find the dynasties or the rulers who were ruling in the northern and central part of Orisha, they were usually following the traditions which were prevalent in the northern and eastern part of India. And not only the script, but also the numbers which were, or the symbols which were there in the northern part of India and eastern part of India, particularly in the middle Gangetic Valley, they were having direct imprint or direct impact on the writing style of the inscriptions in the northern and central part of India. Similarly, we find the traditions which were quite popular in the western part of India, that is western part of Odisha, that is Mekala, Malwa, Vidarbha. From all these places, the traditions flowed to the western part of India. Similarly, in the south, we find there were a number of dynasties in Andhra, particularly in the Krishna and Godavari river basins, river valleys. And there were number of dynasties like the Ikhwakus, Salankayanas, Vishnukundins, then your Eastern Chalukyas. Subsequently, they came to power in the lower Gangetic Valley, lower Godavari Valley. And they had also a different style of writing, and that was known as Andhra in the neighboring region. And from there, the writing traditions, they moved in the northern direction, and particularly in Kalinga, the Matharas and subsequently the Eastern Gangas, who were ruling over there in Kalinga from their capital Kalinganagari, they not only issued a number of copper plate grants and inscriptions, but also in the writings we find there was an indelible imprint of the writing style that was prevalent in the Godavari Valley, by all these dynasties which I mentioned. Now, as such, the geographical, what I try to make you understand is that Orissa was geographically so located that we got the inspiration from all traditions, from northern tradition, from eastern traditions, from western traditions, and also from the Deccan traditions. And as a result of which, we find there were numerous symbols. One particular symbol, one particular number was expressed in different types of symbols. Now in northern India, for example, if you look at the symbol for eight, you will find different types of eights which were found in Orissa, particularly in the 5th, 6th, 7th centuries. In northern part of Orissa, you find a different type of eight. In western part of India, you will find a different type of symbol for eight. And similarly, in Kalinga region, that is in Ganjam, Srikakulam region, you will find an altogether different type of symbol. So all these symbols, they penetrated into Orissa and they influenced the writing style of the region, Now, it was in the 7th and 8th centuries, we find another change in expressing the numbers. Because it was during this time, the decimal system was system of notation was slowly popularized in the western part of India, and Ujjaini was the center where most of the astronomers and mathematicians, they were working on astronomical literature, mathematical literature, and they had written a number of texts. You must have heard about the Gupta age, in which Ujjaini was a famous center, and Aryabhatta, Boramiro, Bhaskar, all these great astronomers and mathematicians were there in Ujjaini. And Ujjaini was emerging one of the epicenters of astronomical studies, or major centers of astronomical studies. And it was during this time that the decimal system was gaining popularity among the astronomers for calculation of astronomical details. And Barahamira had written a book known as Panchasiddhantika. And in this book, he has used the decimal system of notation at different places. And it was the credit goes to Barahamira and other astronomers of Ujjaini to devise this system, Because later on, why I am saying this is that sometime in the early part of 20th century, the Europeans, they claimed the decimal system of notation was their invention. The Arabians, they also claimed that the decimal system of notation was their invention in 9th century. But when we look into the texts, astronomical texts of India, Sanskrit, written in Sanskrit language, we find that the claim of the Europeans and the Arabians as the inventors of the decimal system of notation has absolutely no ground. Because Barahamira had emphatically used this system of notation, and this has been admittedly subscribed by most of the scholars of the world, that Barahamira was the first scholar and even others like Aryabhatta, Varahamihira and Bhaskara, they were the first group of scholars who worked on the decimal system of notation, and they perfected it, not only used but also perfected it in their treatises. And not only these astronomers, but there was also another Jaina scholar known as Jinabhadra Gani. And Jinabhadra Gani also lived in the 6th century AD. Varahamihira wrote his Panchasiddhantika sometime in the year Saka year of 427, and it is equivalent to 505 AD. So by the early part of 6th century, the decimal system was perfected, and this was also used by Bhaskara in the 6th century, latter part of 6th century AD. And similarly, the Jaina scholar Jinabhadra Gani had written a book, mathematical text known as Brihat Khetra Samasa, and in this text, Jaina text also, the decimal system of notation was used by the Jaina scholar. So it can be conclusively said by the 6th century AD, the system was gaining momentum, it was becoming perfect, it was getting perfect, and it was used popularly in the subsequent centuries. And now coming to the Indian epigraphy, there is an inscription known as Mankani Grant of Tarala Swami, and he used, because Tarala Swami in his inscription Mankani Grant had used this decimal system of notation, and the date of the inscription is Kalachuri era 346, and it comes to about 594-95 AD. This inscription is dated in Kalachuri era, and if you add 346 and 248, because the Kalachuri era started in 248 AD, and if you add these two, you are getting the number 594-95. This is the date of the inscription, and this is the first inscription in India belonging to the latter part of 6th century where you can find the perfect use of the decimal system. Those scholars who believe that the decimal system was not popular in 6th century AD, they actually raised an objection, and they branded this inscription as a spurious document. But scholars like D.C. Sarkar and others, G.S. Guy, D.C. Sarkar and others, they have examined the content of the inscription, the writings of the inscription, the script, and even the decimal figures which were used in this inscription, and they have come to the conclusion that the Mankani copper plate grant of Tarala Swami of Kalachuri era 346 is not a spurious document, rather it is a regular document issued by the king Tarala Swami. So now scholars throughout India, they subscribe to this idea, they believe that this is the earliest document written in the year 346, Kalachuri year 346, and it is in the decimal system. And there is a reason to believe to this first use of the decimal system in the latter part of 6th century AC, because from the beginning of 7th century onwards, and even in the latter part of 6th century, we find a number of examples where the decimal system was gaining popularity in different parts of India, and Odisha was one such zone where we find the use of the decimal system. And this system was never perfectly used in Odisha for a century or so, because the first inscription of Odisha that was written completely in decimal figure or expressing in decimal system of notation perfectly, that was the Chikakul copper plate grant of Devendra Varman. He was an Eastern Ganga ruler ruling over Kalinga kingdom, and the date is Ganga year 195, and it is equivalent to 693 AD. 693 AD, remember, 693 AD, Devendra Varman, the Eastern Ganga king, had issued a copper plate grant, and it was perfectly using the decimal system of notation. And this is the first inscription where the decimal system was used perfectly by the Orishan king in his document, in his official charter. Now, there is an interesting story behind the use of the decimal system in this part of the country, this part of the country. Because nowhere in India you will find a gradual development of the use of decimal system as we find in Orisha. And initially when the system was used in Orisha, that was again by the Eastern Ganga rulers in the 5th century, in the 6th century AD. But the system was never perfectly used. There was a constant, the people were actually confused. And as a result of which, people were concocting or mixing together both the systems of notation. Now you have seen that the earlier system was the numerical system of notation, where the symbols were there. Now in the decimal system, you are having 9 unit figures, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and there is a figure for 0, a figure. And this 0 is a potential 0. It is not a cipher. It is a potential 0. So with the help of all these 10 figures, 9 figures and a 0, you can express any number. We are using this now. And this was invented in 6th century, early part of 6th century AD. But the inscriptional use of this decimal system of notation also started from the 6th century AD, and it was perfected in Orisha in the latter part of 7th century AD. So there was a gradual development. People were actually confused how to use this decimal system, because this system involved two things. One is the place value notation, place value there and or is to be there, and there is also the use of zero. And this zero is a potential zero. And those who were acquainted with the numerical system of notation, they were actually confused. And this is particularly evident from the inscriptions of Orisha. And we had a number of examples from Orisha from 6th century to 10th century, where we find that how the writers were confused between the two systems of notation, and gradually after 400 years they perfected in the decimal system of notation, and possibly 925 is the last date where the decimal, the numerical system of notation through 20 symbols was used. And after 925 AD we find there was a continuous use of or popularization of the decimal system of notation in Orishan inscriptions. Now, the transitional phase is very interesting. The transitional phase, meaning the transition from numerical system to the decimal system of notation, this is one of the interesting phases of the Orishan inscriptions. And this is particularly important in Orisha, particularly the we find actually two dynasties. They were instrumental in confusing between these two systems of notation. One is the Eastern Gangas, as I told you, and the other one is the Bhaumakaras. The Bhaumakaras, they also confused between the two systems, and ultimately they perfected the system in the latter part of their dynastic rule. Now, I shall show you some examples, and you can better understand. Now, if Bhaumara or the Ganga era 185 is to be written, then the writers were using the numerical symbol for 100, then writing 8 in 10 place and 5 in unit place. Now, the symbol for 100 indicates that the writer had an obsession for the old system, that is the numerical system, and that's why he had written 100, symbol for 100. But he used the decimal figures for 8 and 5 in the place 10 place and unit place. And this particular process continued for more than 200 years, 300 years to get the idea that the numbers can be written in decimal system. Now I here, these are all Eastern Ganga inscriptions. These are all the inscriptions from Bhaumakura records. Now here you can find, that 80 symbol for 80 is there, and to the right side of 80 you will find the figure for 0, and here the 0 is a cipher. So in order to express 80, the scholar, the writer had written 80 symbol for 80, but unnecessarily he had written 10, and this 0 is a cipher, not a potential 0. Similarly, in another example, 100 is written here and this is a numerical symbol, but 3 is written here and 7 is written here. 137 is expressed in this manner. 100 is here, 100 is here. The 100 sign is always mentioned in numerical symbols, while the decimal figures are there in the unit, in the 10 and unit place. So the writers, what I want to impress upon you is that during the transitional phase, the writers of inscriptions, they were confused between the numerical system of notation and the decimal system of notation, as a result of which they concocted both the systems and tried to express the dates in their inscriptions. Now even the Bhaumakaras, they had also made a similar confusion while expressing the numbers. Now you can find the Bhaumakara records here, and this is the inscription of Dandi Mahadevi. 100 is written here, 80 is written here, 7 is written here, and these are in numerical symbols, but the day is written here, 13 is written here, 1 and 3. So both the systems were prevalent during this phase. Now these are the decimal figures. Now I told you that from 10th century onwards, there was no confusion among the writers and the scribes, and they used perfectly the decimal figures, and the decimal figures were used from 10th century onwards without any difficulty. And these are the figures. One is there. One is written like this. 1, 1, 1. 2 is written like this. 3 is written like this. 4 is written like this. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. These are the decimal figures which were found in different inscriptions from 10th century to 12th, 13th century AD. Now almost all the rulers of different dynasties, they used the decimal systems throughout Orisha. The imperial Gangas were there, the subordinate rulers were there. All these rulers, they used the decimal system of notation in their inscriptions. Now, I shall come to another important aspect, that is the how the modern Orient numerals developed. And if you look at this picture, these are the figures for one, and in the second column you will find the figures for 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Now, from 13th, 14th century onwards, we find the Oriya numerals began to be used as decimal figures in different inscriptions. But most of the inscriptions of 13th, 14th century onwards, you will find that the Telugu numerals, they were actually influencing the inscriptions of Orissa. There are two reasons why the Telugu numerals, they are getting popular in Orissa. The Imperial Ganga rulers, who were ruling from roughly from 11th century, beginning of 11th century to 15th century, they actually came from Kalinga region, southern part of Orissa, and ultimately they ruled over the entire Orissa. And most of the inscription, particularly most of the copper plate grants, they were written in Sanskrit language, and the script that is very akin to Proto-Orya or to the Nagari script, as prevalent in 12th, 13th century in Orissa. But most of the stone inscriptions, they were written in Telugu language or in Sanskrit language and Telugu script, or in Telugu language and Telugu script, and very few were there. They were also written in Oriya language and Oriya script, and some are also there, very interestingly, Oriya language and Telugu script. And there are also examples where Tamil inscriptions are there, or bilingual, trilingual inscriptions are also there, and they all were belonging to the Imperial Ganga rulers. Now, since Telugu was spoken in the region, particularly in the southern part of Orissa and northern part of Andhra Pradesh, naturally, the writers, they were using both, the Telugu numerals while writing the Telugu texts. They were using the Telugu numerals, and ultimately, the Telugu numerals, Telugu decimal figures became very popular in the Orissan inscriptions. Now, if you look at the the figures from 1 to 5, you can very well imagine that the Telugu numbers from 1 to 5, they had tremendous impact on shaping the modern Oriya numbers 1 to 5. And here I can show you the example. Now, this is the Telugu 1. This is the Telugu 1. And this has evolved like this. One is here and another one is here. Now, similarly, 2 is written like this. 2 is written like this. And ultimately, 2 is written like this. 3 is written like this in Telugu script. And it emerged like this. In the subsequent photographs, I shall show you. The 4 is written like this. 4. And this particular 4 is an import from Telugu numbers. 5 is also like this. 5 is also like this. This 5. But these are from northern part of India. And the southern. Similarly, the 6 here is an import from Bengal script. But 7, 8, 9, these are derivations from the Nagari script. I shall go to another. Here you see, and in the 15th and 16th centuries, you will find that 1 is standardized here, Odia 1, 2 is like this, 3 is like this, sometimes 3 is also written like this, 4 is like this, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So, throughout this period, the Telugu influence was much more, and it could directly replace or discard the first five figures from the records of Orisha, inscriptional records of Orisha, and ultimately dominated in influencing the Oriya numbers. So 1 to 5, they were essentially derived from the Telugu script or Telugu numbers. And similarly, 7, 8, 9, these three figures are essentially derived from the Nagari, which were through an evolutionary process. They were very popular even before this. But 6 is a derivation mainly from Bengal. The symbols developed, you can view this one, this is Telugu 1, this is Telugu 2, Telugu 3, Telugu 4, Telugu 5, and how it proceeded like this. You can see 4 here, Oriya 4, Oriya 5, Oriya 3, Oriya 2, Oriya 1, and 6 is mainly developed, borrowed from Proto-Bengali. Or Bengali, but 789, they are essentially came to us through an evolutionary process. Now, apart from this, we have one more system of notation that was also prevalent from 10th century AD onwards, and again in the inscriptions of the Eastern Gangas or Imperial Gangas, and this was known as the chronogrammatic system of notation. And what is this chronogram? Chronograms are the words indicating some numbers, and these words, they express some numbers, and they are very popular among the writers, particularly the palm leaf manuscript writers. They were using this while composing the texts in different meters. And even in prose passages of inscriptions, we find the use of the chronogrammatic system of notation. Now, the chronograms, as I told you, the chronograms are essentially the words which indicate some numbers. Take for example, I shall give you a very small example. Nayana. Nayana means eyes. Hasta. Two eyes. We have two eyes. This indicates that two is there. Similarly, two hands. Two feet. Two can be expressed by hasta, nayana, jugala, pada. So this is a pada, hasta, nayana. These are chronograms indicating a number that is 2. Similarly, guna is an indicator of 3. Triguna, sattva, tama, rajas. Similarly, 7 can be expressed like giri, sapta rusi. So Rusi is a chronogram for 7. Giri or mountain is again an indicator of the number 9, the number 7. Similarly, Ratna is Navaratna, 9 gems, 9 jewels. So 9 is Ratna is a chronogram for the figure 9. Now, there are several such words in Sanskrit which indicate numbers, and they are actually used by the writers of inscriptions and even palm leaf manuscripts, and even the writers of Sanskrit poetics, they sometimes use this. Now, I shall give you one example. For example, in order to indicate the number 2019, 2019, suppose you want to use the year 2019, then you can write it in chronogram. And how can you do it? Ratna Sasi Gagana Nayana. Ratna means 9. Gagan, Ratna means 9. Then Sasi means 0. Sasi means 0. Gagana means Sasi means 1. Because Sasi means Chandra. Chandra is 1. And Gagana means 0. Gagana means 0. Because Gagana means Akasa, Ambara, and that is Sunya, that is considered as Sunya. So, zero is expressed for the sky, and similarly Nayana, Nayana means two. And whenever you are expressing a number, you have to reverse it, you have to reverse it. I shall give you a very small example. Take for example, Nayana, Sasi and Ratna. Nayana, Sasi, Ratna. 2, 1, 9. It is a very small figure. 2, 1, 9. If you are expressing in chronogrammatic notation, you should remember that they should be, once they are derived, they are written from left to right. They are written from left to right. But whenever you have to derive the number, you have to read it in the leftward movement. And that is known as Ankanam Bamatagati, leftward movement of the numbers. Suppose you are getting a number 201, then you have to read it 102. And this particular chronogrammatic system of notation was prevalent in dating the inscriptions. Because you know that the Imperial Gangas mostly used the Sakara Indian inscriptions. Sakara Indian inscriptions. And while expressing the Sakara, they used this chronogrammatic system of notation in their inscriptions. And most of the inscriptions of the Imperial Gangas, particularly the charters, official charters of the Imperial Gangas, these chronogrammatic expressions are there. And sometimes we also find that half chronograms are there. What is a half chronogram? Now take for example Sasi Chandra, Sasi and Gagana. Sasi means 1, Gagana means sky or 0. And if the writer wants to add some more figures, then he can add panchadasa or 15. So half is expressed in chronogram, the other half is expressed in number words. This fashion of writing was also prevalent among the Imperial Gangas and the Gajapatis, and it was not only particularly peculiar to Orisha, but to other parts of the Indian subcontinent, and even in beyond India, we find the chronogrammatic use of chronogrammatic system in the Southeast Asia. And if you look at the popularity of the chronograms, you will find that in the 11th century there were only a few cases. In the 12th century, the curve rises. Then in the 13th century again the curve rises, and in the 14th century we find the maximum inscriptions written in chronograms. But there was a decline. This is the tabular form. This is 11th century. In the 11th century, we have only 20 odd examples which were written in chronograms and half chronograms in Orisha. In the 12th century, we find 50 examples, 13th century, 100 examples, 14th century, more than 160 examples. But there was a constant decline in the use of the chronograms and half chronograms in the 15th century, and again in the 16th century we do not find much inscriptions where the chronograms and half chronograms were in use. Half chronograms were in use. Now, and this system was, as I told you, this system was popular in metrical compositions. Later on, it was also popularized in the inscriptional literature, and mostly found, as I told you, as I have shown in the graph, mostly it is found in the medieval period from 11th century, 12th century, 13th century onwards. It was popular in 15th century, 14th century, 14th, 15th century. Then there was a decline, and half chronograms are also used in the. Now, one more example. Of course, this is not an not a system of notation, but may be fascinated to know what is the Anka era. There is an Anka era, that is an era that was prevalent in Orisha, particularly in the Imperial Ganga and Gajapati period, and even after that. And most of the rulers, they were using the Anka era. And the Anka era year calculation is somewhat different from the regnal reckoning of the rulers. Now, the word Anka actually refers to the regnal year of a ruler counted from the accession of a king, but with a special method of calculation. According to this method, the numbers 1 and 6, remember, number 1 and 6, and all the numbers ending with 0, excepting 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, these are not used. And similarly, the Anka is usually calculated from 12th day of the bright fortnight of the month of Bhadra, and that is also known as the beginning of the new calendar of in Orisha, new calendar of new year in Orisha. And the system was fairly popular among the imperial Gangas and Gajapatis. Now, I repeat that in this system, you will not find number 1, number 6, and numbers ending in 0 except 10. So, if the writer is trying to express the regnal year 30 according to the Anka era, then he has to deduct 1, then 6, then 16, then 20, then 26, then 30. So 6 figures are to be deducted from the regnal year 30 to arrive at the Anka year 24. So the Anka year 24 is equivalent to the regular regnal year 30 of the ruler. So regnal year 30 is expressed in Anka year as 24, because some of the numbers like 16, 20, 26, 30, they are to be discounted from this calculation. Now, so I should stop here instead of going on speaking on different aspects. Let me respond to your reaction. Hello again, welcome back to you all. Now there are 3 questions which have been read out to me by Dr. Umakant. One is the question by Umakant whether the additive and multiplicative system of numerical notation was from left to right or right to left. It is left to right. Because the Brahmi script is also written from left to right, and that's why the numerical system which was prevalent in India was basically a Brahmi notational system. Therefore, essentially it was written from left to right. This was the question from Umakant, and the second thing is that why the Egypt people were claiming that the decimal system was their invention. It was not the Egyptians who had invented the system, because as I have already told you, that the Hindu astronomers centering at Ujjaini, they were the actual inventors of the decimal system of notation, and that has been authenticated by most of the scholars, Sanskrit scholars, astronomers, and mathematicians throughout the world. So there is no dispute now on the origin of the decimal system of notation, and neither the Egyptians, nor the Arabians, nor the Europeans had any contribution in disseminating the knowledge of the decimal system of notation in the world. And Indians, the credit goes to the Indians, particularly the Indian astronomers, to invent and popularize it. And regarding the popularization, particularly the Indian writers of inscriptions, they were actually given, should be given the credit of disseminating the decimal system of notation throughout the country and even beyond. Now Neha has asked one question, the how 548 is to be written. 548 is to be written. Now Neha, five is the chronogram for five is Bhuta, Panchabhuta. Four is for Diga. And Diga. Eight can be also Diga. And four can be Beda. Now, in order to express 5 for 8, you have to write first of all Diga, then Beda. Diga means Ashtadiga, Beda means four, Chatur Beda, then Bhuta. Bhuta means Panchabhuta. So 5 for 8 is to be written like this: Diga, Beda, and Bhuta. Why? Because in this system, first of all, you have to mention the day, mention the chronograms, and while reading, you have to write Bhuta, Beda, Diga, and you have to read like Diga, Beda, Bhuta, meaning 8, 4 and 5, and while reading, you should read like 5, 4, 8, because leftward movement, from right to left you have to read, right to left you have to read. Is there any problem? 5, 4, 8 can be written in chronograms as Bhuta, Veda and Diga. Bhuta, Veda and Bhuta means Panchabhuta. Then Veda is four, Chatur Veda, and Diga is Ashtadiga. And here one thing I should say, that Diga can be Chatur Diga, Diga can be Ashtadiga, Diga can be Dasadiga. And in the context you have to understand what is the writer intended to.